Old School Lane Casual Chats is brought to you by oldschoollane.blogspot.com and is associated with Manic Expression, The Comic Book Cast, the Reopened Nickelodeon Studios in Orlando, Florida Facebook page, the PlayStation Let's Play channel, and For Entertainment's Sake. Happy holidays, everyone. Welcome to a brand new episode of Casual Chats. I am Patricia, and I am here with a very special guest. You may know her from Thrilling Adventure, the JV Club podcast over at the Nerdist channel. You may know her from being the co-founder of FSF Sketchfest. She has been a part of Rift Track, and you may also know her as the voice of Korra from Legend of Korra. I have none other than Janet Varney. Janet, welcome to Casual Chat.
Hello! Oh, thank you. I'm already not casual enough because I just jumped the gun and said hello before you even really introduced me.
It's okay. Well, right here in Casual Chats, we just talk about some questions and some random things, and we'll just see where that goes from here. So, the first question, I guess it's one I want to know, and I'm sure a lot of people would want to know, is that where'd you get your inspirations for wanting to be an actress?
Oh my, I guess I would say that probably started pretty early on because my dad, while he's not a performer per se, was a very animated English teacher and a lover of theater. And I think he really is, you know, in a big way responsible for me getting excited about kind of performing and artistic stuff. My mom was also a teacher, and I think good teachers really are performers. I don't think I'm probably not saying anything new on that front, but my dad especially, just because he's very silly and very high energy and very funny. And so, yeah, and also, you know, I think a lot of performers just kind of feel it from really early on, and I don't even really remember why or how, but I just knew, even when I was in first grade, my school was doing a production of Snow White, and I just knew I wanted to be a part of it. So sometimes it really is just kind of like in your blood, I guess, which sounds really obnoxious, but it really was something. Like, I was lucky enough to be cast as Snow White, and I was put in a really horrible, like, thrift store short brown wig that my white bangs were kind of sticking out from underneath, and I'm sure it was, like, the worst world, but, you know, I was bit by the bug pretty early, and I've kind of been doing it ever since, and for a long time it was just for fun, but about 10 years ago, I was sort of started getting handed opportunities to do it on a more professional level, and I just felt like I had to take advantage of it. And so I kind of just, you know, been doing it forever. But, you know, I took a really long break from really pursuing it on any real level when I was in my kind of late teens and early 20s, and then it came back around. So a lot of the time, I've said this before, but a lot of the time someone from, like, elementary school or junior high or even high school will say, like, I always knew you were going to end up doing this. And I'm like, well, yeah, but, like, you need to know that there was a 10-year period when I had no intention of doing this. So it's kind of funny that I ended up coming back around to what everyone thought I was going to do, but I didn't really see that myself.
Now, did your parents support you on wanting to become an actress, or did they, since they were both teachers, did they want you to do maybe a teaching position or maybe something that would be a much more, like, more focused, like, career? Like, they want you to be a doctor, or they want you to be, like, something like that?
No, and I feel really lucky, because I never felt that at all. I never felt like they didn't support me with kind of being artistic. And in fact, I think my dad was maybe even a little surprised, and I don't want to say disappointed because that's not true, but I think that he really believed in me to the point where he was surprised during that time that I kind of stopped doing it. He was like, what are you doing? You should be doing this. This is something that you love. You know, you're good at it. And I was almost more practical in some ways than he was at the time. You know, I was just like, but Dad, I don't know. This isn't like the most sound professional career. It's not, it's, you know, there's a lot of stuff that's real superficial about it. And that makes me uncomfortable. And it's not very secure. And I think that he just always kind of believed in me so much that he was like, oh, that stuff, that you'll be fine, you know. And I guess there are times when I wish I could have seen that or felt that for myself, but you kind of have to, you know, follow your own path and learn your own lessons.
Absolutely. And I think for anybody who wants to become an aspiring actor or actress, in some ways it has gotten a bit easier, but in other ways it's gotten a lot more difficult. You know, when you're talking about mainstream Hollywood, you have to look a certain way, you have to perform a certain way, you have to follow all these strict rules. But then at the other hand, you have something like the internet, in which people are becoming more of online celebrities in some, you know, some ways, like doing reviews or doing like their own little short films or doing animated projects.
Sure. And that is something that's been, that's really fun and exciting to see and to be able to use, you know, to point, kind of point at it in the way of, you know, there is an opportunity for people to find their own voices and kind of do what they want. And I'm always so excited. And I think most creative people and fans of creativity are when they see somebody who's doing something that you've never seen before or that feels, you know, very fearless in that way. Like, oh, this is just this thing that this person loves. And it feels very authentic, and it feels, you know, like risky in some ways, but also it's, we can hold this up and say, well, if this person can do this, then I can too.
Right. Now, you know, with you wanting to become an actress, you know, when you were doing all these performances in your school and other little side projects, what movies and TV shows or actors and actresses did you get inspirations to want to continue that to pursue in acting?
Well, that's a great question. I definitely was a big, you know, kind of TV nerd and movie nerd. I would, like many of us, I would watch the same movies over and over again. I think that's something that for sure is true when you're a kid, but some of us are more kind of obsessed and compulsive about that even as we get older. And when I was in high school, I definitely would just, you know, watch taped episodes of Kids in the Hall over and over and over again and rotate my crushes on the different kids depending on whoever I was most into at the time. Like, right now, Mark McKinney's my crush. And then, you know, Steve Martin, Jodie Foster. It's funny because there's not really like a hard and fast rule of who I just looked up to and thought was, you know, amazing. There's a real cross-section. And I think a lot, I mean, it's, I hate to say it, but like, again, a lot of the early stuff for me was because of my dad. You know, my dad was a huge Steve Martin fan, and I became a huge Steve Martin fan very early, thanks to the Muppet movie. And, you know, my dad was a huge fan of the Pirates of Penzance movie, which is, you know, my dad's not a big musicals guy, but he loved Kevin Klein. So he showed me this Pirates of Penzance movie that Kevin Klein is the Pirate King in, and I, you know, became obsessed with that movie. And maybe that had something to do with wanting to be a performer, you know, because it's very performance and music and dance oriented. And so I would just watch. And then when I was in high school, I would like, you know, a lot of the times, like my friends would be going to do something else. And I would be like, I'm going to go to the movies. And I would just go to the movies by myself. And I remember when I was in high school seeing, like, there were certain movies that I just saw over and over again, because I loved the way that they made me feel. And I think that, you know, I was talking to someone, I think I was doing another interview a couple weeks ago, or maybe it was even my own podcast, the JV Club, but someone was saying, you know, I think you probably always did, I think it was Jamie Denbo, the part of you that, you know, we all have those passions, and sometimes we don't acknowledge what they are or exactly what they mean to us, but she was like, I was like, yeah, but, you know, I wasn't, I did, as I was talking about earlier, oh, that was that period, there was that period of time where I wasn't really that into performing, or, you know, I didn't think I was going to end up doing this. And she was like, be honest, though, even during that time, when you went to the movies or saw a show or something live or music, did you feel that pull, you know, like there's an invisible rope kind of pulling you towards the stage? And I was like, God, you know what? I think I did feel that, which again seems super obnoxious because it feels like that must mean, look at me, but it's not really that. It's just like the feeling that you get as I think hopefully those of us who are lucky enough to discover a passion, whether that passion is, you know, defending, being a public defender, which is so important, or being a social worker or being a teacher or, you know, finding something, whatever that is, that you feel that invisible rope pulling you towards. I guess I never really lost that. And so I think that's, I felt that way about movies and TV from a very young age. And I just kind of, you know, followed that obsession, I guess.
Yeah, and especially since there are so many different varieties when it comes to acting. There's stand-up, there's acting in movies, acting in TV shows, voice acting, acting on stage. What made you decide when, you know, pursuing in all of those things that you felt that, you know, doing things like improv or doing skits would be very comfortable for you as opposed to acting like in a big, you know, like constantly acting in movies or in like being like recurring in TV show after TV show or doing voice acting?
That's a great question. I mean, I think some of it is just opportunity. You know, when I was in college, I was a theater major and I really didn't do anything comedic at all. There was a really great improv group at both of the colleges that I went to. I started at the Northern Arizona University in Flagstaff, Arizona, and I did 2.5 years there, and then I moved and transferred to San Francisco State because I really wanted to live in San Francisco, and there were great improv groups there in both places, and I just didn't think of myself as that person at all. I never had a real sense of myself as, even though I loved Kids in the Hall, Mr. Show, and all that, I didn't, and Saturday Night Live, I mean, I guess in the back of my mind, I was like, oh, God, I love, you know, funny sketches. And I think all kids, at least many kids, even if they don't end up being performers, like doing kind of funny skits for their parents and stuff like that. And I did all that. But I really thought that I was like, I mean, I honestly, like, I think if you had asked me in high school, like, who would you want to be and whose career would you want to have? I would have said Jodie Foster. And we don't generally, although she's very funny, we don't generally associate her with, you know, light comedy and sketch.
Right.
And so in college, I was very, you know, serious and doing Shakespeare and doing Sam Shepard and, you know, doing all of those kind of like predictably intense, if, you know, wonderful, but I was doing these kind of intense plays, and like that's what I felt, you know, my strength was, and I was completely intimidated by improv and comedy, and it wasn't until I had finished at SF State that a couple of friends of mine from the theater department decided to form a sketch group, and even that, I mean, they really had to pull me in kicking and screaming. I was like, I don't do this, I don't do improv, I don't write comedy, and they said, oh, just come, and it'll be fun, and I honestly feel like, you know, I feel like I've given them a lot of credit for my career, but honestly, I mean, I really have to give it up for, especially my three sketch comedy partners, Gabe Diani and Cole Stratton and David Owen, who are still in my life as close friends, and also I work with all of them in various capacities, because they just believed in me, and they really thought they saw something, and they kind of helped me overcome my insecurity about it. You know, I was not, just for anybody who's like, oh, you know, performers probably, like, they probably just know that they've got it, or like, you know, even if they're insecure, they push through it. And it's not always true. I really needed that support from people I thought were hilarious and that I really respected to kind of bring me to where I could feel comfortable doing that too. And I think that's a real, just coming, circling back to the improv idea, that's an idea and a feeling I have kept throughout my life. I would much rather be working collectively with people I think are funnier and better than I am, who lift me up, than being out there on my own thinking I'm the best, or even taking the chance, not necessarily having the confidence, but just, you know, stand up to me is so terrifying because it feels like it happens in a vacuum. And that's not true. You know, I have such close friends who are stand-ups, and it's not a vacuum. It's something that you exchange with the audience, and you learn what's funny through the audience. And so in that way, it is very collective. But to me, I want, like, the reassurance of, you know, a rehearsal or an improv set with people that I respect, who I feel, you know, are going to keep it going and keep it funny along with me, and who make me better at what I do. And maybe that's lazy, but to me, it's very, like, hippy-dippy, but that's where I feel my best work.
I don't think that's lazy at all. I think that's very creative, and it's really spontaneous, because coming up with a very funny moment in your head is one of the most difficult things that you could ever do, especially if you have to do it in one quick second and they're already waiting for the joke. I think with stand-up, it's like, for some people, it's like telling a story or it's saying a bunch of random jokes that have no connection whatsoever and eventually making the people laugh for some reason or another. I think with improv and with stand-up, they're completely different things, but at the same time, you have to be able to keep the audience. Otherwise, then you're just going to have a whole bunch of dead air and the people are just going to walk away from you saying that you're terrible, that you're not funny. But I don't think that's lazy at all, Janet. I think that in some ways or another, I think that improv can be just as difficult to pull off, even harder than stand-up. And I think that it's definitely a lot more worthwhile seeing that, because you saw that it's really spontaneous and, just pull it out of a hat and you can be able to make it as funny as if somebody were to think of that joke overnight.
Well, I appreciate that. I mean, I do think there's something really ephemeral and wonderful about seeing a great improv show. And I remember before, because even with Totally False People, which was the sketch group that I was in for years that included the people I just mentioned, Dave Cole and Gabe, I still wasn't really doing improv. And so I got into improv like a couple of years into doing sketch. And I remember before I was really comfortable doing it, seeing the Upright Citizens Brigade in New York. I mean, it's such a cliche now, but that was before Amy was on Saturday Night Live. And I remember seeing all four of those guys. And I remember Andy Daly was there. And I can't remember who else. I think it might have just been those main five. But I was breathless. And I think people who, love seeing improv or doing improv and love the excitement of the spontaneity of that get a high from it, just like I did when I saw them. I was dumbfounded, and I was already working in comedy to some degree, and I was still blown away. And I maintain that I've never seen anyone better at improv than Amy Poehler. I mean, I've seen people as good as, but I've never seen anyone better. And she was the first girl I saw do improv where I was like, I don't even know what's happening right now. This feels like magic. And it was really inspiring. And it wasn't scary in the way you would think that seeing someone who's the best at something would be, because she is so warm and funny and down to earth, even on stage, that it doesn't, you don't feel like, oh, your majesty, you know what I mean? You feel like, oh, I want to play with you, and I still haven't had the opportunity to do improv with Amy, but she was a huge influence.
Oh, absolutely. Amy is so amazing. And, her and Tina, when they pair up together, it's like amazing.
It's nuts. It's nuts. I really do feel like it's almost like that's a different language those of us who feel like they're the best at something. When we see that, we're like, I don't know. I kind of speak that language, but not really.
Yeah, I get what you're saying. Another question that I have, a few years, like right after the TBS program Dinner and a Movie came along, you became one of the co-hosts. How did you get the opportunity to do that?
It was just, it was sort of an audition. It didn't start as an audition. It started as a meeting. But that was a show that was on actually for so long that I watched it when I was living in San Francisco, and I watched it. I mean, I loved it. I thought it was really funny, and that was definitely during the period in my life where I had no intention of being on television or being a performer, really, other than being in a band in SF. And I was very surprised and amazed and delighted when, it was less than a year, maybe it was like 6 months after I had moved to LA, that I, that was asked to meet with someone at TBS. They were just like, oh, they just want to meet, funny people, want to see who's out there and you're new to the scene and they want to meet you. And what I didn't know was that they were looking for a new host and they didn't express that. So it was kind of nice because it was real low pressure because I wasn't really auditioning for anything that I knew about. And then, to my surprise, after that meeting, later on, my managers called and said, like, oh, actually, they're considering you for a Dinner and a Movie. And I was like, Dinner and a Movie? I watched Dinner and a Movie. And so the audition ultimately was actually that I went to the Los Angeles Culinary Institute or something where they had set up a kitchen and a couple of cameras. And it really was just, the audition was just exactly what we ended ended up doing on the show. They just kind of threw me in with Claude and Paul, and you know, turned the wolves of Paul and Claude on me, and we just got along really well, and I guess we had some great chemistry, I hope, because I did end up getting the job, and I did that for 7 years, and it was just such a joy. We shot it in Atlanta, and we had an just amazing, wonderful crew of people whom I miss so much, my Atlanta family, and Paul and Claude are still very much in my life, but, you know, I don't get to see them the way I got to see them when I was on the show, and that's one of the really hard things about this business, is that you form these really close relationships, and they are people, as we all experience when we love our coworkers. You know, it's very emotional when those jobs end, or if we get laid off, or if we get fired, or if we quit, all of those things, you know, in any walk of life, when you walk away from people that you used to see on a daily basis, it's a real adjustment.
Yeah, I understand. Regarding about dinner and a movie, did you guys come up with what movie and food themes you were going to put together, or did one of the writers or the producers do that for you, and you just, you know, talked about the movie and then ate the food afterwards?
Oh, you know, we did. The three of us were responsible for everything. So we would, you know, we'd be on the phone together, or we would watch the movies together, or we would all meet at TBS. It was kind of a combination of all of those. And they told us what movies we were going to watch. So that's what TBS brought. They would say, you know, otherwise I don't, all due respect to the movie Rush Hour and Rush Hour 2, I doubt that we would have watched that movie as many times as we ended up showing it and doing recipes about it. But we were given a list of the movies that we're doing. And then the three of us were responsible independently and together for coming up with stuff. So Claude was generally the genius behind all of the punny titles and the recipes. He's an amazing chef. He's cooked for Alice Waters. He's cooked for Julia Child. I mean, some people don't know, but he is like a world-renowned chef. And then Paul and I would, you know, come up with stupid sketch ideas, but sometimes Claude would give us great ideas, and sometimes we'd pitch titles of recipes to him, and it was a really great cooperative effort, and it was a really, really great training ground for me, because I had, again, just moved to LA, and to be able to be handed the responsibility of, you know, writing and coming up with ideas and representing myself and my ideas on camera it was really great. It was a different experience than just showing up to a set where there's a script and, you know, being an actor. So, and I was lucky enough to be doing that at the same time. So it was really great. I have so many people that I owe so much to for embracing me and, you know, helping educate me as I was kind of getting my feet wet in this business.
Yeah, that sounds great, Janet. Now, if dinner and a movie were to come back today, and if you were to think of like a food theme for like one of the newer movies, what would you choose and why?
Oh no, it's a lot of pressure. A lot of pressure. This is a real improv exercise. Gosh, let's see. I'm trying to think of any movies that I've seen recently.
It could be an animated movie. It could be a comedy, drama, anything you want.
Yeah. I would say, all right, here's something that just popped into my head completely off the cuff. This is not going to be funny, but this is what improv does to you, is it just forces you to spit things out, hoping someone else will make it funny. How about if we watched the movie Despicable Me and we did Delectable Meat?
Hmm, nice.
We could do a little play off of that.
Have an antipasto.
A little antipasto, absolutely. Absolutely.
That'd be kind of cool. Yeah, I can see that.
I gotta get Claude on the phone. We gotta get this going right away.
Yes, definitely. Call him back. Tell him, you know, do Despicable Me.
Drop everything, everyone.
Yes, exactly. I can't wait. That would be awesome to see.
Oh, I would go back to that show in a heartbeat if it still existed.
Yeah, trust me. I mean, eventually some things do come back. You never know what could happen. I mean, this is
Hollywood. No. Well, listen, it had a good 16-year run, so exactly. Either way, I guess I can't complain.
That's right. Anyway, another thing that I want to discuss with you about that Kevin and I were really excited to be talking to you about was you were a part of Neil's Puppet Dreams with Neil Patrick Harris, and I listed that recently on my top 5 puppet programs for adults that you should check out that nobody talks about. So,
great! Well, I'm sad that nobody talks about it, but it is true that
There are some people who do talk about it. No. There are some people who do talk about it, but not as, you know, extensively as something like maybe Crank Yankers or Avenue Q. Neil and David come up with the idea?
That was something that felt very organic in a lot of ways. We, When Neil and David and I first became friends years and years ago, we discovered very quickly that we both, or that all three of us, had a real passion for the Henson Company, and just, we're kind of obsessed with Jim Henson and the Muppets and all his Creature Shop and all that. And so I had definitely had a long-standing dream to work with them, and I had become friends with their kind of head of, I guess their PR department, but it's such a small company. It's really just sort of a family of people who do a lot of different things. And I had always said, like, I'm just telling you, at some point, I really want to work for the Henson Company. And so when Nerdist had this partnership that they created with the Henson Company on some projects, Chris actually came to Neil and me and said, I think you guys should do something together. And David luckily was also available to be a part of it, and he's just brilliant and creative and wonderful. And so we just tried to think of some sort of premise that made sense for this opportunity to create short sketches. And we all also like kind of absurd, strange things. And so we were like, well, what if every time Neil falls asleep, depending on what the circumstance is, maybe it'll actually inform the kind of dream he has, but he just let's have him dream in puppets. And this is actually before, like later on, someone was like, hey, did you know that there's something in like 30 Rock about that? And I was like, oh, that's crazy, because that's a real example of the collective conscious. I'm sure they didn't steal it from us. I'm sure we didn't steal it from them, but that's good. It was a weird coincidence, although I have a bunch of friends on that show. So, but yeah, it was like, it turns out a lot of us who grew up with Sesame Street and the Muppets, love the idea of kind of us interacting with that world. So it was really amazing. It's one of the coolest things I've ever worked on, and we definitely want to do a second season. It's just, it turns out Neil Patrick Harris is the busiest person in show business.
Well,
So,
of course. I mean, this is NPH we're talking about.
yeah, it's NPH. So we talk about it all the time. We talk about it all the time. And I think one of these days, hopefully next year, the talk will actually, create a carving out of time, and we'll be able to write some more episodes.
Absolutely. I would really love to see that because Kevin and I are huge Muppet fans, and just seeing that, it was just brilliant. I mean, just seeing all the puppets coming together and doing some very hilarious antics and dancing scenes. I mean, it was just fantastic. And, I really like the lullaby that you wrote in the first episode about when Neil is falling down toward the sky. I thought that was
Oh
really great.
yeah. Well, that was a fun thing that that David and I really sat down and did together, as executive producers and writers, is we were like, okay, what are all the kind of classic dreams? Like, what are those sort of Freudian dreams, and what are the kinds of dreams everyone can relate to? And we kind of just turned them all on their ear and went from there.
Yeah, I think that with Neil's Puppet Dreams, I think that was a great way of just showcasing about, just what kind of creativity you can do with puppets. And I think that, puppetry, done for all ages is a very rare thing. And I thought that that was really fun to see.
Thank you.
Another question. Now, speaking of the Nerdist, how did you get the opportunity to do the JV Club at the Nerdist channel?
Oh, well, that's just, I mean, that is something that was kind of presented to me from the very beginning, because at the time, I was in a relationship with Chris Hardwick. So
Oh.
that's something that he always knew. Like, when he started his podcast, I was very much kind of a part of that from the beginning, in terms of seeing what the process was and what the kind of pitfalls and opportunities were. And obviously, Chris really built an enormous empire, for which I was present that throughout that whole process. And we're still very, very close, and I love him so much. And he's such a, speaking of people that you like having around you that, inspire you to be better at what you want to be doing, he's definitely one of them. And so he was like, even when he started his podcast, he was like, oh, by the way, you also should start a podcast. And I was like, I don't have time to start a podcast. And he was like, no, but for real, you should seriously start a podcast. Like, just think about it. And so that kind of stuck with me, and he would like prod me about it. And eventually, I did kind of come up with an idea that I felt like excited about, and that I felt was a bit different and wasn't really already being covered in some way. And he was like, I love it. That's it. You have to put it on Nerdist Network. And I don't even know if we were together by that point, but I always knew that it would end up there because it was just a natural home. And yeah, I just love doing that podcast so much. I've really had a lot in the last few years. I've felt like, I don't know how, like, I've had such incredible turns of luck, but I love all of the things I've been a part of in their own way, and I'm so blessed to have had the career that I've had, but there were just kind of a coming together of things that all happened at once that I would say, I guess the main three would be that I started working on Cora at the right around the same time that I started the podcast, and then I was also working on Burning Love around the same time, and actually Neil's Papa Dreams is part of that as well. They're just like a real culmination of things that I just felt so passionately about, and that I just enjoyed so much, and felt so honored to be a part of, and to have all of those things happening at the same time, or having that kind of overlap. It is a little bit, there were a lot of moments where you're like, I don't know how I got so lucky, you know, and I'll never not feel that way about, you know, those things that I just mentioned.
Absolutely. And with, you know, all those shows combined and all the projects that you've done, and, you know, with, you know, for a lot of younger listeners out there, I mean, especially with Cora, I mean, Cora is part of like this big Avatar franchise that people are absolutely loving. I mean, they say that, you know, for some people, it's like the next generation of Star Wars, in which you have this rich universe filled with all these complex animals and these complex characters, and putting into various situations where, you know, it kind of broke the mold when it came to discussing about what a kid's show is, especially with Nickelodeon. And, you know, I think that, you know, you're part of something really big, and I'm sure that you've probably been, you know, told this millions and millions of times, but I'm sure it must have been an amazing experience with you working on Cora, and I just want to thank you very much for, you know, being so passionate about voicing this amazing character. I mean, sure, you know, throughout the beginning, you know, Cora had a lot of ambitious personalities with, you know, being really all kind of, how would I say, she was very like very cocky, and she was really, you know, willing to do anything even though she doesn't listen to reason. And I saw that, you know, she was really growing as a character, especially with the season 4 episode Cora Alone, which was an amazing episode, and you pulled it off very well. I think that, you know, Cora is definitely going to leave a huge impact on people.
Thank you so much. I mean, I'm sure people are tired of me waxing rhapsodic on that show at this point, but I just can't believe that I got that job. I still kind of can't. I mean, here it's been like 5 years I've worked on it, and I still pinch myself, and I still get emotional with every single episode. It doesn't even matter. Like, it doesn't matter if I'm in them. It doesn't matter. It's just such a special, special show. And of course, The Last Airbender is such a special show as well, and just to have been given the keys, kind of in the sense of like, here, you'll have your own key to open this door, as Mike and Brian and all of the amazing writers and animators and musicians and performers that had to do with that job, that we all, you know, got us a set of keys, that we got to kind of come to that world in a different way than just as viewers. It's just astonishing to me. And what's great about Mike and Brian is that, you know, in a lot of ways they give everyone a key, because because the books and what they talk about, the cons, and just really being honest about their process and stuff, is, I just think it's so special. I think it's so special the way they invite people in. Like, they don't talk down to their audience, and they know that you know, fans of the show will take as much information, big and little, as they can get, and that they're willing to say, yeah, this is what we had in mind for this. And like, look, here's this cloak that we designed for Kuvira, and then we ended up changing it. Like, that they know and respect the viewer enough, you know, the fans enough to share that process, I think speaks volumes for not only their generosity as artists, but also their appreciation, their understanding and respect for the fans. You know, it's very copacetic in that way. It's symbiotic in that way.
Absolutely. And, you know, with you being a huge Avatar fan yourself, are there any other Nickelodeon programs that you were a fan of when you were younger, or just became a fan of more recently?
Well, I watched You Can't Do That on television every day. I feel like I watched it multiple times a day, so maybe they shared reruns. My dad thought it was a ridiculous show because it's so not for grown-ups.
Well, not true. I mean, there were lots of episodes that were kind of grown-up. Like, there was the smoking episode. There was the episode that talked about drugs. Yeah, there were a lot of episodes that were for adults.
He just thought it was like, I think in his mind, it was just like a bunch of kids being obnoxious and then getting slimed. Not that he really stuck around for the deep stuff. But yeah, I mean, I'm sure there's other stuff I watched on Nickelodeon, but that was really the early days of Nickelodeon. And, And I loved it. I do remember being very envious of those kids, like, how do they get to be on this show?
Yeah.
And so I have, you know, a long time love of Nickelodeon, and I've been so welcomed in by them, and I've, you know, started doing voices on Sanjay and Craig, which is like a
Oh,
hilarious show. It's so silly and ridiculous and funny and so farty. There's just so much farting,
yeah. And
but
of
it's.
course, Chris Hardwick is great as the snake, Craig.
Oh yeah. Well, that's like there's. I think that's the third major show that he's been on a Nickelodeon, and that was something that I watched with admiration also because he did a show called The X's, and then he was on a show, and he was on Back at the Barnyard with this amazing cast that included Maria Bamford, and yeah. I mean, it's such a fun group of people, and it's so different from Korra. It's fun to just kind of get to do like just absurd, crazy voices. But I love Nickelodeon. They've never been anything. And I did a movie with them that was live action with Jerry Trainor from iCarly, and I just love them. They're just great people, and they have a great sense of humor, and they really tapped into the comedy scene, and they know the value of the talent in the comedy world, which I'm such a huge fan of so many comedians and so much comedy that it really I appreciate that they're kind of have their eye on the prize in that way.
Sure, that sounds great. Especially, with recently they celebrated their 35th anniversary.
Yeah, it's so crazy.
I know. Right before we go, Janet, with me being a huge fan of your podcast for over a year and a half, you do this little thing at the end of every podcast in which you and your guest would play a game of MASH. And
Yes,
so
indeed.
in honor of this, I was thinking maybe I can play a game of MASH with you.
Oh, I would love to. That's really exciting. I don't get to play it very often.
All right, so I have some questions right here, and I'm sure for any of the listeners who don't know the rules, it's very simple. I ask a question, Jana gives me three different answers, and then at the end, I draw this little circle, and whenever she tells me to stop, I count how many are in the circle, and then I just cross down the answers, and then I get to tell what her future will be.
I'm very excited.
All right, so let's start off with the first one, and this is one that you've asked numerous times on your podcast. Real or fictional, if you were to bring any band into your life, who would it be and why?
Oh, good one. Good one. Okay, any band that I could have play music for me and stuff, huh? Okay, I would pick The Clientele. The early days of The Clientele, I sound like such a music nerd, but like, they aren't as good as anymore. They're still great, but there was a very raw sound that they had when they first started out. They're a British band, and I always think that their music sounds to me like the sun's going down and it's foggy somewhere. it has this. I think I've said on my podcast before that I like music that makes me feel happy and sad all at the same time. And they are kind of the kings of that, especially in the early parts of their career. I would pick Mark Kozelek, who lives in the Bay Area, who I wish was my friend. His bands, the Red House Painters and Sunkill Moon, are very much also examples of music that makes you feel happy and sad at the same time. And then I would pick maybe, oh man, this is tough. Just like when I do this to other people and then I laugh at them for how hard they say things are.
Don't worry, I'm not pushing you.
Oh God, I feel like I gotta get a lady in there. I mean, I guess I gotta go Joni Mitchell. Let's just go back to the source of it all. If I could have her around and she thought I was cool, I would just feel like the coolest person.
All right, sweet. And okay, three locations. If you were to live in any three locations, what would it be?
San Francisco.
Okay, San Fran.
Let's go with Oslo, Norway.
Oh, nice.
Oh, it's so great over there. But probably only half of the year because the times when the sun never comes out would be very hard.
Right.
And then I'm gonna go with God, how far away would I be willing to be? I don't know. You know what? I guess I'm gonna throw Portland in there.
Okay, Portland. Okay. Okay, now if you had the ability to do anything, like if you were to fly or if you were to have super strength? What you know, magical abilities would you have?
I think I'm going to go with the perennial classic, run really fast, okay. Because I miss being able to just, I used to love going running, and it's really bad for my knees.
Right.
Because now I'm an old lady with bad knees, so
it
would be really fun to run super fast. I think that even more than flying, I would love to run, like, so fast, like the X-Man who, you know, was running so fast that, like, time to that person mm-hmm. feels like everything else is moving really slow.
Mm-hmm.
When they kind of kick into gear. The next one would be to be able to speak any language, like the moment someone opened their mouth and spoke a language anywhere in the world or even the universe, that I would just be able to speak it. And then I think to be able to be completely and totally safe yeah, in no danger whatsoever, to be able to just be in the ocean and check everything out.
Celebrity crush.
Oh, celebrity crush. Oof. Celebrity crush. Who do I have a really bad crush on right now in a great way?
Steve Martin?
I mean, I had to kind of let that go because when I moved down here and he had been, and I knew that he had dated Anne Heche and stuff, I was like, oh no, maybe I could really date him. But then, like, it turned out that he was already getting married to that wonderful writer from New Yorker. But, God, I'm going to go with, I'm going to go, but you know what? I will go back in time. I'll go back. I'll pick some crushes that, like, I felt like my heart was going to break if I didn't marry them. So I'll go with circa Man with Two Brains, Steve Martin.
Okay.
I'll go with circa Night Shift, Michael Keaton.
Ooh, nice.
And I will go with, I'm just going to throw a woman in there because I really did have like a sick crush on Jodie Foster. I'm going to go with circa Hotel New Hampshire, Jodie Foster.
Sure. We're open here. Not a problem at all. Okay. Any three foods that you can have and you won't have any consequences on weight gain or illnesses or anything like that? Three favorite foods that you would eat for the rest of your life.
Okay. I would eat, I brought it up on the podcast once and I can't even imagine what would happen to me if I ate it now, but they used to have this cake at the Alcove. I think I talked about it with Christian Schaal. I can't believe I actually remember that. It was basically like if you had a banana split, but it was in cake form. It was like vanilla cake, and then it had like a ribbon of chocolate in it, and then it had bananas in it, and it had a lot of whipped cream.
Oh, that sounds delicious.
It was really, really good. It was like a banana split cake. Okay. But with no ice cream, of course.
Okay.
Next one would be, I had this, this is a very bougie answer, around this time last year, I was lucky enough to be taken on a beautiful dinner in New York City, to the restaurant Jean Georges, and I had this soup, it sounds so dumb, but it was like an elevated version of like tonka soup that you would get at a Thai restaurant. So like a little bit of kind of coconut milk, the sort of a hot and sour, but also very creamy because of the coconut milk, a little bit of a fish thing happening. But it's one of those flavors where like every sip I took, I felt like I was having an entire meal in one sip. And it was just so lovely. And you know, when you can sometimes, I was not really a foodie, but I do now acknowledge that sometimes you can taste like the love that someone puts into something. And I just was like, I love this soup. It's so dumb. I never thought I would say fish soup, but it really was a very emotional soup eating experience for me. So that, and then the third thing would be, I'm going to go with, again, this is not something that I would necessarily pick now, but out of total love and shout out to my late grandmother. She and I both shared a very, very strong love for frozen Snickers candy bars.
Oh, yes.
Minis, little miniatures. And so I would have unlimited frozen Snickers miniatures, preferably with my grandmother.
Oh, that is so nice. All right, and final one. Real or fictional, if you can hang out with any person for just one day, who would it be?
Oh, it's going to be so painful if it's only one day.
I know.
I don't even know if I can answer Emma Thompson because, like, I would be shattered that it was only one day. So I better pick someone that I really would be okay with only hanging out for one day. Okay, people would be okay with hanging out for one day. Oscar Wilde.
Ooh, nice.
Hang out for only one day, but I still want to hang out with them. Let's go with Margaret Atwood and Dylan Thomas.
Awesome. And
I feel that all three of those people, after one day, would be like, okay, I'm done.
Let me know when you want to say stop.
Okay.
Okay. Well, I tally up and tell you what your future holds. I'm going to ask you another question. What were your experiences working with the guys over at Riff Tracks?
Oh, God, those guys are the best. I could not love those guys more. The whole company is fantastic, but of course the people who brought Cole and me into the fold were Bill Corbett, Kevin Murphy, and Michael J. Nelson. They are total heroes of ours. We both loved MST3K growing up, and when we had the opportunity to write for them, and then when they asked us to write our own stuff, we were both just like, this can't be happening. We still work with them. They're so funny. They're so kind. They're so warm. I hate to say this, but I feel like I would, if I could vote for three presidents, I would vote for all three of them to be president together. I just believe in them as human beings, and they're also brilliantly funny. Three of my favorite people, those three. And Michael J. Nelson also knows that I love his wife so much that I kind of wish I could just move in with both of them and be like their adopted daughter, even though we're not that far off in age. I love them. I love them. I can't say enough great things about them. I'm so excited to see them this year at Sketchfest. I can't wait to perform with them and hang out with them. And I just, they're the best.
Awesome. And I can't wait to hear what the new movie is going to be that you and...
Oh, my God. We have had to put off our record date like three times because of Sketchfest. We're so busy.
That's okay. Well, I'm sure that the wait will be worth it.
I hope so. No pressure.
All right. So I got your future right here.
So,
congratulations, Janet. It looks like that the band that will be performing for you will be The Clientele.
Oh, that's great.
And you will be relaxing in your nice big home at San Francisco.
Oh, that's wonderful. Oh my God, this is so great.
And you won't have to worry about any crime over there because your ability will be that you will be safe with no danger.
Oh, wonderful.
And you'll be having, you'll be in that apartment, not worrying about any danger, with Michael Keaton.
Oh God, listen, this is a little too good to be true. This is pretty phenomenal.
Yeah. And the both of you will be having a delectable dessert of cake.
Oh, the cake. Oh, I'm just going to smear that with cream all over Michael Keaton's early 80s body.
And you better save a little bit of that frosting because you'll be spending an entire day with Oscar Wilde.
Oh, wonderful. Oh, I'm going to have so many bon mots after I hang out with Oscar Wilde.
That would be
wonderful.
Amazing. And, that should wrap things up. That concludes this episode of Casual Chats. And right before we go, Janet, do you have anything to plug or self-promote?
Oh, my gosh. Well, I think that we probably did an entire podcast of self-promotion, so I don't want to make anyone sick over it. But I will say that SF Sketchfest, we just announced our lineup yesterday, and we are so, so very excited about what we've got coming up this year. And I am there for the entire time. I'm in San Francisco at the shows and performing in some of them, and it's such a great time, and we have hotel discounts on our website, and so I just say, you know, anybody who's listening who wants to come out to San Francisco and hang out and see some amazing comedy should come out. It's January 22nd through February 8th, and then listen to the JV Club podcast. Those are the two big ones, I guess.
All right. Sounds fantastic. And once again, Janet, thank you so much for taking the time for this interview.
My pleasure.
And you have yourself a wonderful holiday and you have a great 2015.
Thank you. You too, Patricia. Thank you so much. Tell Kevin I hope everything goes all right.
I certainly will. And we hope to see you around in 2015 where we'll have more topics and more special guests. So take care. We'll be right back.
kittens from trees or lunch on skyscrapers.